what I focus on in that nation. I don't speak Portuguese, so Felipe is always beside me. I learned how to slow down, how to say things and phrases, and so it's actually not so usual now for me to speak without an interpreter. So it's very freeing, though. I have to say I really enjoyed it last night. It was wonderful. I wish we had time. If you will be quick, I would like to take 5 minutes, no more. But I really think that it's important and valuable. I think it'll give us just a break from hearing three lectures in a row. But I would love for you to just, maybe three, four, five of you, to quickly stand or shout from where you are a phrase or a statement that you are going to take home with you that you have heard in one of the multiple messages beginning from the opening night. And I will start. The opening night, for me, it was reinstated in me that God wants to use whatever our past is to bring revival, that your past becomes your message. And so we don't have to be ashamed, and he will use anyone. That was my takeaway from the first night. But just stand, what has been imprinted on you? I would like to facilitate that discussion for just a moment. Will you quickly respond?
Stay in shape.
Stay in shape. Great. And we know what shape means. Okay, someone else, yes. He will fix a fix to fix you. Everybody want to say it with me? He will fix a fix to fix you. Now let me finish it. If you fix the fix that he fixes, he will fix another fix to fix you. Do you think you could say that? He will fix a fix to fix you. If you fix the fix that he fixes, he will fix another fix to fix you. Okay, someone else? That's great. What is another thing that you're taking away from any of the messages? Yes. We have strength in our weakness. Incredible. Somebody repeat for me, I can't hear it. Obedience is the anointing that remains. Someone else? We need revival in our churches, a visitation of the Holy Spirit. And we are the ones who facilitate that. Someone else?
Having the right people on board will cause you not to lose precious cargo.
Oh, so good. Having the right people involved will cause you to not lose precious cargo. That was an incredible insight. God is positioning you. What I want to show you is there is a theme and a thread that the Holy Spirit has put together. It's like a puzzle that is creating a picture for all of us. And that picture with the diverse pieces of the puzzle unifies us in our values. It unifies us in our character because we're family. And I see a real strong theme of God really tweaking us. A tweak is just a little bit off, and he's pulling us back into plumb line in the way we think, in our character, in the way we live, and then in the way and the methods that we minister. So this morning, a familiar passage, there are two that I'm going to talk to you out of, but I want to share with you what I call the principle of process. Everybody want to say process? Because growing in God and God using our lives, ministry, when we come into Christ, we come in, truly come into a process. And so Matthew 26:26 is the very last dinner that Jesus had with his disciples, and his actual commission from his Father God was coming to a completion in that season in his life. The season of taking on the form of a person, of a man, coming to live on this earth and modeling the life that God has prepared for each one of us. And then, as we just heard from Pastor Emmanuel, we then model the life for someone else. And it continues. Our hearts of gratitude for the generations will rise to a level when we realize that Nigeria would not have the presence of the gospel had people in generations before not stewarded it in their own life and example and taught it to the next generations. You and I wouldn't know the gospel. We wouldn't have the gospel in the West if people had not traveled from these continents over here and brought us the gospel. There would be no gospel in Brazil had American missionaries not gone to Brazil to teach the gospel of Jesus. And so our hearts of gratitude to steward what others have brought before us in the generations of my family. My grandmother was baptized in the Holy Spirit when she was out in a wheat field. She had read in the scriptures of the Holy Spirit descending on and revealing and filling the disciples in the upper room and the people in the upper room. Grandma had never heard of Pentecost. She had never heard of speaking in tongues except what she read out of the Bible. And it was out in a field that Grandma was praying, and the Holy Spirit baptized her. I was talking to a very close colleague of mine who is a very strong conservative Baptist, and she doesn't believe, she truly doesn't believe as strong conviction and with scripture proof that the gifts of the Spirit passed away with the disciples and that there has not been a valid visitation in the more modern world. And I truly believe there is, and so do you. And we weren't arguing over it. I was respecting her for what she believes, which is very different than mine. And she said to me, "Devi, what text, you love the word like I do, what text can you actually use for to really prove that the gifts are for today and that speaking in tongues is an evidence or a sign or one of the evidences of being filled with the Holy Spirit?" And I said, "The text that I can use is the life of my grandmother." My grandmother was in a field. It was the experience, it was the testimony, and then it was the process that my grandmother lived that passed that conviction, the awareness and the experience. And that's what happens. That's what mentoring is mentoring engages all five senses. Mentoring is not preaching. You cannot mentor and you cannot disciple from the stage. You inspire and you motivate, and then you connect one-on-one to bring what you are inspired with, the large picture, the concept, the principle. We were given a concept this morning on entitlement, but you will only really understand what entitlement is when you talk about it across the lunch table today. What did you get out of that? What does that mean? How is that revealed in my own life? I never saw this before. And you begin discipling with the principle that you learn. Jesus was doing this because he was no longer going to be with them. And they had had dinner together. And it was at that dinner that we model what we call a religious ceremony, by the way. It has become that. We call it communion. But Jesus picked up the bread And when he picked up the bread, if you look in this text, there are four words I want you to circle. And I would really love to encourage you as teachers of the word for you to really get in the habit of taking notes with every speaker. Every speaker has a truth that will be important to you. And we don't retain just by hearing. So with your iPads, with your telephones, find a piece of paper, a pen, and become a note taker. Verse 26 says, now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread. I want you to circle the word took. Matthew 26, 26. Is that, am I right? Yeah, 26, 26. Matthew 26, 26. Now Jesus, they were eating and Jesus took the bread. I want you to circle the word took. And after blessing the bread, he broke it and he gave it to the disciples and he said, take, eat, this is my body. Now, there are four action words here. Is he took, he blessed, he broke, and he gave. So I want you to circle those because I believe Jesus' final meal demonstrated a process that is a process we can look back in history and we can look forward in our own lives, and you will see that this process is valid today. And it will help you in the stages that you go through in your personal lives to really understand what is happening right now in our life. He takes you, he blesses you, he breaks you in order to have something to give. He takes you. So he takes you from a circumstance or a situation that you are in. And stop and think about when Jesus takes someone from sin. He saves them and redeems them and sets them free. They're not free yet, but the promise of being set free and the empowerment of being able to be set free from whatever that grip of sin was on their lives, he removes us from that. And always a new believer, you can see that they go in through a season of being blessed, don't you? Don't they? I mean, it's like God answers all of their prayers. He doesn't answer all of my prayers, but if you're a new believer, he answers prayers, miracles, there is provision. It is amazing the season of blessing that happens in a new believer's life. And then there will come a season of breaking because you don't live in that blessing forever. You don't live in it forever. There will be a time of breaking. That break, the breaking is, it can be in discipleship. It can be laying our life down. It can be dying to the flesh. It can be a circumstance that that tests our character. So he will break us, and it is in the breaking that the proving time comes, and it is in the breaking when we submit to the process of the breaking that we then will be have something to give. And he demonstrated this here, but if we look back in history, we can see how God took the children of Egypt, took the children of Israel out of Egypt. He removed them from their circumstance and he blessed them with the most divine miracle probably recorded in history, was the parting of the Red Sea, the folding back of the waters in order to protect them from the enemy seizing them and annihilating and killing them. And he blessed them with an unbelievable miracle. After the unbelievable miracle, what happened? They were now on the other side. Their enemy had been completely wiped out. And they went into the desert 3 days without water. Now, how is it that God would remove you from Egypt, would bless you with a miracle, and then now put you in a situation where you don't even have essential substance to sustain your life? Why would he bless you with the miracle when there was all the water in the world of the sea and then take you where there is no water? As long as a human can survive without water, he made them survive. And he broke them in that circumstance. And you can see this process throughout the scripture. He took Jesus from being a carpenter's son. And he blessed him with declaring, John the Baptist saying, behold, Jesus, the Lamb of God, the Son of God, who takes away the sins of the world. And he was blessed with the descending of the Holy Spirit on his life. So the fullness of what his purpose and calling could be complete in the moment. And then what happened with Jesus? He was led by the enemy to temptation. And what areas of temptation was he tempted in? And I want you to listen to me, because these are the very same areas that exist today. The enemy hasn't changed. He has not changed. You know why he hasn't changed? His tactics are the same. It's because God created humankind. He created us, and he created us in his image. And we are created a tripart being. We are a trinity. We are a body. We are a soul. We are a spirit. And our souls are sensitive. We have minds. We have brains. We have thinking power. We have spiritual sensitivity within the spirit of man. And we have a physical structure that contains and holds all of that. Satan's tactics are the same to come against the body, the soul, and the spirit, and they don't change. And when Jesus was taken to the Mount of Temptation, he was tempted in three areas. He was tempted in provision. And for us in ministry, provision is a big issue. I remember when Larry and I, 52 years ago, we were married, and he promised me nothing. He did. He promised me nothing. He wrote me a letter, and he said, I have no idea what our life or our future will be. He was already in full-time ministry, so I didn't know, but I knew he was a preacher. I had no idea what a life of ministry meant, but I knew he was a preacher, and in our days, that was really someone to be respected. That has changed a lot in the generation that we live in. But to me, to marry somebody who's in ministry, someone who is of the cloth, would be like marrying someone in high society. I didn't think of it as being a place that we wouldn't know where our next morsel of food would come from. I had no idea that within the first year of our marriage, well, we had water, because in America, our water is clean and it's almost free. It's cheap. We waste water. And so we had water, and water sustains us, but there were times that we didn't have food. There were, if a lady, a little old lady that we had met when we first married, if she had not given us from her pantry her big jars of home canned tomatoes, and somewhere I guess I came up with enough money to buy a big bag of macaroni. And her home canned tomatoes, I'm talking just canned tomatoes. I'm not talking about sauce, or I'm not talking about spices. I didn't have spices. Spices are expensive. I didn't have spices. I had salt and pepper. So our provision is a really big deal, especially in pastors, and especially when God calls you and takes you from where you are. I know pastors who've been taken from leading big companies, and God called them to go into the ministry. We have a young man working for us. He's from Brazil. He's a genius. A young man. He is an absolute genius. He's in his early 30s. And when I see the little boys, when I see them selling on the streets here in Nigeria, from 5 years old, he sold on the streets in Brazil. His father had left them, and his mother did all the best she could. And so he was on the streets. He wasn't educated until he was 18. And there was an employer who discovered his value. That employer took an interest in him and paid for him to go to school. And he learned to read and write when he was 18. And they discovered the genius that was in him with technology. And he kept being promoted and given opportunities, sent to America to work, sent to Europe to work. And he was making big paychecks. He had never had money. He didn't know how to manage the money. And that's what happens in the area of provision. Provision becomes such a temptation in our life. And if there is a perversion that will begin creeping into our lives in ministry, it's going to be in the area of provision. And this was the very thing that was demonstrated in the process of the breaking of Jesus himself. It was the very thing that was tested in the children of Israel after the miracle was provision, was going into the desert without water. And then stop and think about this. So when they did come to water, what happened? The water was undrinkable. Now talk about torment. That's just plain not fair. It's one thing to have no water, and it's another thing to have had no water and come to water that if you drank that water, you would die. The water was polluted. The water wasn't drinkable. And yet here was water before you, and your mouth is parched. And it's much more parched than my mouth is right now, which I need some water. I'm recovering from laryngitis, and my throat is still a little weak. Excuse me for drinking that out of the bottle in front of you. But so provision is a really big deal, and it's an area that we have to be cautious. We can come up to what looks like provision, and it can be death to you if you take it. I remember one time, opposed wealthy man. Remember the man Larry referred to? Was it last night or the night before that was in our early ministry, and he was an embezzler and a thief and stole so much money out of the ministry? He was on staff with us for 5 years. And he would come to us, presenting to us to buy these huge gifts or to pay an addition to build onto our home. Our home wasn't large. I had people in for dinner all the time. And he said, your dining room is so small. Betty and I want to add an addition onto your dining room. And I prayed about it, and the Holy Spirit said, no, what you have is fine. And I said, no, it's okay. You don't need to do that. Be careful, because provision can be your bitter pool. And if you drink of that bitter pool, you will die. And the enemy will tempt you with provision. That same man tried to give me big diamonds and jewelry. And we went to Israel one time. And, I was just young. I was in my 30s. I was young. We were young. We were in our first church. And he would always try, because he posed to us as a wealthy person, a man of resources, a man of business, a big pool of water. That's what he posed to us as. So you would think it would be God, wouldn't you? Yeah, yeah. Oh, thank God for the miracle. But there is a process that he's taking us to so we can get to the date palms. But in that process, after the blessing, after the miracle, after being removed from captivity, from the bondage of the enemy, and preparing you for your future in this process, and I want to tell you, I have come to know at our season in life that the process is cyclical. It never stops. It's cyclical means like a cycle. It never stops. In our season right now, Larry and I are in the season of blessing. But it wasn't long ago until we were in the season of breaking. And after this season of blessing, we will have new revelation, new insight, expanded vision, and expanded impact. And you know what? When we get there, you know what he's going to do? He's going to take us from that place, and he's going to call us to do something that is going to require faith again. He will. And he'll do that to you too. We never stay in one of these places. We don't know the timing of how long each stage is, but I can look back over our life and I can see that Jesus was demonstrating a process. And it's a process that if we acknowledge it and recognize it, we can embrace it in the moment of whichever phase we're in. My husband has raised up what you don't know about our past and our lives is God has used him since a young man to lead revival, to facilitate the move of the Holy Spirit. And in doing that, to see thousands of people come to Christ, hippies, off the streets, drug addicts. We brought them all into our homes. And I facilitated his call as his wife. I never resisted that call. It was a lot of hard work for me. But I did trust him. But our lives were at risk. He would pick up hitchhikers and bring them home, filthy, dirty, sweaty, awful. But we were in the process. He would raise up a big church, and then that big church, God would say, leave. And I want you to go to an inner city of a very depressed city. It's the second least desirable city to live in the United States. And Larry said, babe, God called me to go start a church there. And we were leaving a church of probably 2,000, 2,500 with a great expense account, a one beautiful home. Our kids lived there, and he took us from there. And you know what? He blessed us. It was amazing. Weren't those early days fun when we went to Youngstown? He blessed us. We started in a crummy old hotel, a little room, and we had come from a big luxury sanctuary. We had come from a staff, a team, a school, a television, all of it. And we pared down. We drove one car for 13 years. And I'm talking, this wasn't that long ago. He'll take you. You're not going to be where you are forever. And if you're in the same church or the same city where you are, you're not going to be there forever. In other words, you're not going to be in the same place doing the same thing, hopefully, God forbid, 10 years from now. Or 5 years from now. Because he'll take you either from a place of complacency or a place of success. And he'll challenge your faith in order to expand your vision. And I'll tell you what, I don't want to live a life that is not challenged by faith. Yeah. I don't want to be mediocre. When I was 50 years old, I asked God, okay, first my mind was saying, oh, you're going to be 50. I can't believe I'm 50 years old. It's about midway through after having turned 50. I remember sitting in my chair in our family room, and I said, God, I'm 50. And I have 20 more years to make a difference. Show me how to focus my life. And I was making a difference then. We were in this depressed city. Larry had started a church. I was leading the women. I raised up a citywide women's ministry, filled an auditorium of 2,000 women in that depressed city. We shrunk our lifestyle because we no longer had all those accounts. We started with nothing. So we sold two. We had two cars. We sold one. We drove one car for 13 years. He will take you. But if you'll be faithful, and he'll tempt you in provision. We sold a car. We bought an inner city house. We lived in a black neighborhood, a drug-infested neighborhood that my black affluent friends would not come and do a prayer walk there with me. Debbie, that neighborhood is too dangerous. And I said, that's fine. Somebody else will. And I rallied six women. And every week, we walked every street in that neighborhood. It was one of the most violent neighborhoods in the city. And we were out walking. And we'd stand in front of each house, each shack, each garage where people were living, each broken window place. And we would stand in front and we would cry out for those people. Those are people. God, you are big enough to bring revival and to restore this depressed neighborhood. And I believe you for it. And you know what? In the next year, there were so many miracles of provision. It was unbelievable. But within the next year, our youth pastor came from that neighborhood. Whoa. Within the next year or 2 years, one of our prominent, the most gorgeous worship dancers came from that neighborhood. One of the lead singers in our choir came from that neighborhood because we dared to go out and stand and pray over every house. Hallelujah. And I want to motivate you and I want to challenge you that when you go home, you look at your neighborhood differently. You look where God's put you. Amen. He took you from somewhere and he put you there. Amen. I have to tell you, when I drove in here, my son, Frank, I had seen the vision of this place. I didn't just see it as a local church. I saw it doing exactly what we're doing right now. It is a training center for West Africa. And when we mobilize the leaders in West Africa, and not just mobilize them, but invest in your lives with character and with principles that will lead you to the date palms, that will lead you to prosperity and fruitfulness in your personal life, in your ministry, in your morals, in your character, and we lead you there to the date palms, you're going to go through a process. But I saw it so clearly, and I remember when I stood out on the concrete, that building was just a slab. The foundation had been laid, and I walked out in the middle of that concrete. There were a few of us there, and we prayed for what God was going to raise up here. And when I drove in the first night, I could hardly see the beautiful building for seeing this other building that has taken all the view, taken all the presence, taken my dream of owning that lot too. And I was aggravated and frustrated when I looked at it. But when I left last night, I left blessing it. I left blessing it. We've got to relook at the way we look in our neighborhoods. Because there's a lot of things in the neighborhoods that you don't have, that you need in your ministry. There are resources that you legitimately need. But if you'll go back into that neighborhood and say, God, you took me and you put me here. And I'll embrace the process that you've given me to walk through. And you've blessed us. You've provided for us. There is a miracle of provision. This building wouldn't be here if there wasn't a miracle of provision. There is no possible way the givers, the donors, in our own monthly earnings could erect a building like that. There has been a miracle of provision. But I'll tell you what, you don't stay in that miracle. There are times when you get to that bitter pool, you have some decisions to make. And you know what God said to Moses? He said, I want you to take that branch and throw it into the water. Now, let me tell you, that is not logical. And when you are in that place, nothing starts making sense to you. It's almost as if what God requires of you doesn't seem like it's logical. And logic is the enemy to faith. Yeah. Logic sees on the outside, but faith sees on the inside. And it's not logical to throw its branches in pools that create pollution. Why would I throw a branch in a pool? God, that's not going to purify this water. Take me somewhere else. Create a pool. Rain out of heaven so we can gather the pure water and you can give us water, do something. But putting a branch in that water doesn't make sense. And there are things that God will ask you to do that do not make sense. But if God asks you to do it, you better do it. And you know what? Sometimes I can't tell if it's God. Sometimes we think he speaks to us and we don't want to be presumptuous, for sure, which is the second temptation, provision and presumption. When Jesus was going through his process, the enemy tempted him with presumption. Presumption is doing something crazy and expecting God to get you out of the mess that you created. Felipe taught on that so clearly today. Presumption is making an assumption that somebody else will fix the fix that I fixed. And it was presumption that the enemy tempted him in. And then the enemy tempted Jesus in power and ego. I'll make you ruler over all the kingdoms. Nothing makes sense in logic, but obedience makes sense. And here's what Larry always says to me. You know what, babe? We believe God called us to do this. And we did it. We stepped out to do it. And you know, everything we believe God called us to do didn't work out. And he said, but that's okay. It's better that we step out and try than to be fearful and never do anything. Because of why? We're afraid of our provision. We're presumptuous that somebody else will come along and help pay the bills. No. We got rid of a car. We reduced our payments. We reduced our lifestyle. We lived in the inner city where we bought, it was a big house, but it was a rundown house, and I made it beautiful, but it was cheap because most people don't want to, especially white people, won't live in that neighborhood. And a lot of my black friends won't live in that neighborhood either. You know why he brings us to the bitter pool? Because he wants to see what's on the inside of you. That's why. This process, this breaking process, exposed the interior of the bread. He broke it open and he wants to see. And Psalm says, I want truth in the, don't just tell the truth. I want truth where? In the inward parts. And in those inward parts, what did they start doing when they got to the bitter pool? They began complaining. Is that right? Complaining, murmuring. We'd rather eat garlic. We want to go back. How is it you could put us in this situation? They were angry. They were frustrated. They were weak. And they were complaining. But here's what God's plan is. You see this? He'll always have one of these for you. There'll always be an instrument, a tool, a circumstance, a person, because he's going to use that instrument to open up and reveal what's on the inside of you. And it's what I taught you last night. He loves us so much, he fixes the fix. He'll set the trap. But it's not just to catch you and to get you. The reason is he has date palms waiting for you in your future. Waiting for your marriage, waiting for your family. Some of you have gone through unbelievable things. Like I would like to say, have you ever experienced something that you never thought in the whole world you would ever have to experience? Yeah. I have. Yeah. Why? I want you to just look back and think of what was your reaction when you experienced that? Because that's what God wants to know. And here's what he does. He puts the instrument to the messenger, and he begins a process of opening us up and revealing what's on the inside, because it's the inward parts that matter, and what happens here is going to determine what happens in our futures. What happens here is going to determine what happens in our homes. What happens here is going to determine what happens in the hearts of your children. And this is what is so important to God, that he will submit us to a process. He'll take us to that bitter pool, and he will require something from us that we didn't expect. And many times, it's not logical. We had a... let me just cut this open. I'll put the microphone back, because I want to show you something. We had a friend, Pastor Frank, I'm going to go over a few minutes. Is that okay? It's 12 o'clock. Yes. You want me to finish? Are you okay? I knew I would, but I figured once I got up here, I was in charge. There was a young man we took into our family when he was 17, and he truly was an orphan. There were three children. They all had a different father. His mother was an addict, and just a trail of men lived in their home as he was growing up. And he got saved. And we brought him into our home and into our family, and always we're still family with him. He's in his probably close to 60 years old now, late 50s. And he made some really bad decisions in his life, very bad. And his shame was so huge for the bad decisions that he made, he disconnected for a season from us and from everybody. He moved across the country where no one knew him. He really tried to hide, create a new life, and it would be a life that he thought he deserved, which would be a life without God. But the problem is, when you move, God moves with you. A son never loses his sonship. Although we didn't have his address, we still had his name written in our hearts and our prayers. And he went through a real agonizing time, emotional. And it was coming. He even packed all of his books, all of his Bibles. He was so depressed and so discouraged, so filled with shame. He drove them by just a church on the street that he found the door unlocked. And he took all the boxes of all of his Christian material and he just anonymously set it on the church step, ridding his house of anything that was resemblance of the life he had lived in Christ. But one day, God showed him a pillar of fire. And he said to him, "Son, I want you to embrace this. I want you to walk up and face this pillar of fire. And I want you to grab it and draw yourself close to it." Here's the point. God will put the squeeze on us. He'll create a circumstance no matter what. And he'll put pressure on you. He'll put you in a vice grip. And he'll squeeze you until you think you're going to die. To embrace a pillar of fire is to embrace your own death. And he said, "Embrace it. Embrace it. Embrace it." And he said, "I can't. I won't." He said, "Embrace it. I won't." And the squeeze continued. "I won't." But until he was willing to embrace that pillar of fire, the trial, the test, this is an action of love. But why? Because he wants to see what's on the inside. And you know what? What comes out of us during this time is what is going to determine what we do in our future. This is right here. So don't despise the pressure that you're in. Don't despise it. Embrace it. Throw the branch into the pool. And here, there's something really interesting about a lemon. Because this is fairly unuseful. Oh, you can grate the rind and get some fragrance, and you can use it in a few things. But when it is submitted to the pressure and to the process, there are hundreds of uses of lemon juice. Lemon juice purifies. Lemon juice cleanses. Lemon juice takes away spots, brown spots. You can use it in your laundry. You can use it to cleanse the bacteria out of your toilet. Lemon juice is an amazing thing, and that's what comes out when we submit to the squeeze in our life. When Larry went through the deepest, darkest trial of our life, and it was when this embezzler was revealed. We had such a thriving church, such a thriving ministry. We were really a leading example. And we were in our 30s in America. We were a leading example in worship music. We were a leading example. We were some of the first people who used the arts and used the dance. And we introduced a new level of worship. The evangelism was unbelievable. People were coming from all over the United States to sit in our church to experience the power and the presence of God. And then we discover that we have an embezzler in our midst, and our corporation is bankrupt. He gave us false audits. He gave us false accounting, false book. He was connected to the mafia. So then what happened to him? Was it this man or was it this man that God was after? Who was it that God cared about? It wasn't this man in the moment, and he cares about him, but the squeeze wasn't on him. The squeeze was on him. Yeah. Why? Because if you experience huge success first, you're going to have a turn of brokenness. Most people have their brokenness before their success. But for some reason, God let us have our huge success first. And you're going to know the nature of Christ. And you're going to know him both in the power of the resurrection and the fellowship of the suffering. And it was in the fellowship of the suffering that we left that ministry. And for the next 4 years, my husband was in a dark depression. And I don't know if you know what it's like for a wife to live with a man in dark depression and have 2 children. I bucked up the best I could. I tried to fill in all the gaps, give him a lot of space. And God was good to us. He was faithful to us. But it was during this process of the bitter pool, God said something to Larry that is really, really valuable. He said, if you never do things for me again, will you still love me? And I ask you, in your ministries, we become so works-oriented that everything, all of our spiritual identity is wrapped around what we do. So we left there. We didn't have a big church anymore. In fact, we had a shamed reputation because most people in the media blamed us, not the man who did it, because they didn't know the real story. We create assumptions and judgments about things we know nothing about. Don't do it anymore. To your brother across the street or next door. Don't do it. But it was the process he was after because he knew he had a future for us. And he knew if we stayed down the road of success, we would be tempted with power and ego, and we were. Which was the third temptation for Jesus. And we were. But when he put the squeeze on it, the true nature came out. That God, if we never do anything big for you again, we will love you and we will be faithful to you and we will honor you and we will serve you in our hearts and in our character and in our marriage and in our family. And it doesn't matter how fancy our church building is. If our name is ever on a billboard, if anybody ever invites us to speak, those things don't matter. They are not our motivation. And Moses picked up that branch and he threw that branch into the bitter pool in obedience. And when he threw that branch into the bitter pool in obedience, that water was immediate purified. And if you read in research, you will see that that water was filled with dolomite. Dolomite is a combination of magnesium and calcium. And it's what they give to athletes to build their strength, to build their muscle. And God not only gave them water, but he filled water with the vitamins that they needed, with the strength that they had lost because they were in without water. They were in the testing. Then when he came in, when you obey, but you can't partially obey. You have to totally obey. And that water, they drank it. It empowered them and it infused them. And they stopped grumbling, complaining. And the next path, the next place they ended up in the process was the date palms. Not only provision, it was prosperity. It was prosperity, fruitfulness, fullness. Not only do you have provision for yourself, you have provision to give to other people. And you begin flowing out of your life, your testimony, your experience, the love of God, the test in your life and in your character and in your calling. And that's when revival starts. And guess what? You won't stay there. After a while, you'll be there and he'll take you again. He'll take you again and say, now, next, I want you to do this. 5 years ago, I flew home from Brazil, and the voice of the Lord spoke to me and said, Devi, I want you to accept every invitation you receive to Brazil. I have to tell you, I've never had a calling to Brazil. It's a nice country, but I don't speak their language. Their food is different. The culture is different. I had a very full calendar in America. I love doing what I did. But he said, I want you to accept every speaking invitation you receive. And in the airplane, I said, okay, I will. I rationalized that it would be 2 to 3, maybe 4 invitations in a year. Okay, I guess I could fly to Brazil 4 times. But no. I was there 30 times last year, 30. See, when God, when you embrace the process, you have no idea the future that God has for you. He took me from America in the last, I just started my fifth year in Brazil. And once I was always gone to Brazil, people look at my calendar on the internet, they don't invite me because they know I'm not available. So basically, my invitations in America went almost down to nothing. But he called me to a nation that I was invited to come to. And I've been serving a season of prosperity because we're willing to embrace the process of brokenness, of coming to the bitter pool. And as we close this incredible morning of teaching, I just want to ask you a question. Which of the four are you in right now? Because we're all in one of them. And you have the awesome privilege of moving to the next one. And when this comes your way, don't run from it. Walk into it. Dare to let him expose. And you know, I have to say, back then, there's a lot of things that God wanted to remove that weren't healthy in the way we thought, the way we did ministry. We had great results, but it wouldn't have sustained for 52 years. And he wanted to remove those in our life. But now, bring it on, Daddy. Bring it on, God. Whatever it is you have for me next, I will embrace it. I want to do it. And you know what? There's not so much junk in there anymore. Everything is useful. And I have something to give to others. And you do too. And you do too. Will you embrace the process this morning? And know any of the phases are important and vital. And when you get in your success phase, don't for one minute think you're going to stay there forever, because you won't. And it's okay, because it's his process. I want to pray for you this morning, because I believe the accumulation of these messages has brought us to, God is doing a purification in us, because he has a future for West Africa. And you know what I believe? I believe the Holy Spirit showed this to me after I arrived here. We're not the only ones that God is using for a new model of ministry in your continent or in your nations. But we are a significant one. Amen. And I believe through Kingdom Global and through the leadership that God has given us in strategic nations that are here, I believe you're going to raise a standard. Amen. It's a standard. You're going to elevate a standard of ministry that your brothers and sisters are craving, but nobody loved them enough to show them or tell them. They're only repeating what they've seen the previous generations do. That's what we were doing in the beginning, early. We only repeated what we saw the other people do. But God gave us a new standard. He gave us a new model. And we're raising a new standard and a new model. And it's that our hearts are pure on the inside. And our homes are in order, and our marriages are honorable. And then we do ministry out of the life of example, and we serve, and we love our people, and we are not presumptuous, and we don't feel entitled. We are just as happy to sit in the back seat as in the front seat. And that's the standard he's raising. And when this standard is known to your people, and you may have to confess to them, you may have to repent to them. You may have to teach them the standard. And don't say this is cultural, because it doesn't fit into the kingdom culture to lift yourself up and put other people down. But if Jesus be lifted up, he said, I'll draw all men to me. I would like you to turn and pray for each other as we close this session. And I want you to pray that the Holy Spirit will complete his work in our hearts this week and adjust our ways in the name of Jesus. Humble us, O God. Humble us in your presence. Humble us in your presence, Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I want you to pray for each other. In the name of Jesus.